welcome the marvelous light. The Bible says in 1 Peter 2:9 that God has called us out of darkness into His marvelous light. Psalm 119, verse 130 says the entrance of God's Word gives us light. 1 John 1:5 says God is light. Jesus said in John chapter 6 that the words He speaks are spirit and they're life. Hebrews chapter 4 tells us that the Word of God is living. So when we meditate on the Word of God, we let the Word of God dwell richly in us. The Holy Spirit breathes on that Word. That Word is alive. And that Word brings the light of Christ into us. We can shine with more light when we feed on the Word of God. That's what God called us to. Out of darkness into His marvelous light. Well, we're continuing our study on recovering the glory of God in the church and in the life of the believer. And the pathway to the glory of God is sanctification. It's holiness. The glory of God is something that's missing in most of the church around the world. But God is moving now, awakening hunger in churches and in individuals all around the world to regain the glory of God. We know by the Holy Spirit there's something missing. We need His presence. We need His power. We need the glory. Occasionally in church history, from time to time, even in recent church history, we've seen the times when the glory will be poured out, or the anointing in a mighty way. But usually it's not lasting. It may last for a few months, in some places maybe even a few years. But God's plan is that the church, according to Ephesians chapter 2, verses 21-22, the church would be built together into a holy dwelling place of God in the Spirit. The Lord Jesus is going to have a church that's glorious in the beauty of holiness. That's what Ephesians chapter 5 says. The Lord gave Himself for the church. Why? That He might wash her in the water by the Word, that He might sanctify her and present her glorious. So we see again in this passage that sanctification by the washing of the Word is the pathway for the church to return to the glory of God. There have been times in recent history where we've seen mighty outpourings of the Holy Spirit, but they haven't lasted. There was one in Toronto, Canada, in the 90s. And for several years, it was a wonderful glory of the Lord. It's not the same now. We saw in Florida, in the United States, 1995, in Brownsville Assembly, the glory of God poured out there for a season. But it hasn't lasted. Before the Lord returns, there's going to be an even greater, intense release of the glory, the very atmosphere of heaven in the church. The glory resting in the church. Believers walking in the glory, shining with glory. Isaiah 60 says that glory will be visible, shining light in the church and on the believers. That glory will last until the Lord returns, because we're going to learn how to walk in the beauty of holiness. That's what makes the church glorious. So how do we walk in this holiness? Through the sanctification of the Spirit by the Word of God. In our last episode, we looked at Hosea chapter 14. I'd like to read it again, because this is one of the keys to sanctification. The Lord says, O Israel, return to the Lord your God, for you've stumbled because of your iniquity. Take words with you and return to the Lord. The Lord Jesus prayed in John 17, Father, sanctify them by the truth. Your Word is truth. When we take the Word of God and meditate on it, let the Word of God dwell in us richly, and then we also turn the Word back into a prayer. That's what God says in Hosea 14, take words and return to me. Then God tells them, it's written in the Scripture, what they should say. They said, take away all iniquity. Receive us graciously, for we will offer the sacrifices of our lips. The literal Hebrew says, we will offer the bull calves of our lips. They would offer animal sacrifices. So God says, offer to me words. The sacrifice of your lips to me. And then God tells them what to say. Assyria will not save us. We will not ride on horses, nor will we say any more to the work of our hands, you are our gods. But then they're to tell the Lord, for in you the fatherless find mercy. So we can take the principle that's found in Hosea 14 and apply it. We can take scriptures and return to the Lord. The Word of God sanctifies us. We can put it in our heart, meditate on it, and then pray it back to the Lord. Here's God's response in Hosea 14, verse 4. When they take words and say to the Lord what He wants them to say to them, God says, I will heal their backsliding. I will love them freely. My anger is turned away from him. I'll be like the dew to Israel. He shall grow like the lily and lengthen his roots like Lebanon. His branches shall spread. His beauty shall be like an olive tree. His fragrance like Lebanon. So let's take the Word of God that sanctifies us and washes us. Let's let it dwell in us. Let's meditate on it. Let's take the Word back to the Lord in prayer. God says, I'll be gracious. I'll receive you. I'll make you beautiful. He'll make us walk in the beauty of holiness. He'll make us to abide in Him if His words abide in us. That's what the Lord Jesus said in John 15. He said, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, you'll bear much fruit. He says later on in the chapter, your fruit will remain. That means it'll be eternal. When we stand before the judgment seat of Christ, the fire will test all of our works. But if we've been abiding in Christ and His words abiding in us, then we'll bear fruit that will go through the fire and will remain with eternal reward. That's what we're interested in. So we looked in our last episode at the topic of humility. Over 10 years ago, the Lord spoke to me about a few topics that I should get scriptures on, compile them, put them on a card, and meditate on these and let them dwell in my heart and then let them become prayers back to the Lord. We made these cards available to our congregation, the church that we've been pastoring for about 23 years. And the first topic He gave me was humility, because the Lord said to my heart, He said, if you're going to walk in the beauty of holiness, it will only happen by my grace. And I give my grace to the humble. So we looked last week at taking scriptures on the topic of humility, meditating on Him, holding Him in our heart, praying them as a prayer back to the Lord. This is a process that the Holy Spirit uses to sanctify us. And sanctification is an absolute requirement to walk in the presence and in the glory of God. If you're a believer, that's what you were born for. If you're not yet giving your life to Christ, today's the day of salvation. Don't wait. Call upon the Lord. Trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. Believe that what He did on the cross, He bore your sins. He shed His blood in your place. He paid the debt that you and I couldn't pay. He rose from the dead. He now is seated at the right hand of the Father, and He's coming again in glory. Call on His name. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord Jesus will be saved. And then walk with the Lord. Let His Word dwell in you richly. The Lord Jesus said in John chapter 14, verses 21 and 23, He said, whoever keeps my words is the one that loves me. My Father and I will love him. We'll come and make our abode, our dwelling place. The Lord Jesus said, if you keep my commandments, I'll come and I'll reveal myself to you. Keeping the Word of God in our heart is how we're going to be transformed by the Holy Spirit into the image of Christ. Humility. God gives grace to the humble. John the Baptist said in John chapter 3, verse 30, He must increase, I must decrease. Let's meditate on that. The Lord must become the Lord Jesus, the magnificent obsession of our life. We must decrease. Philippians chapter 2, Paul writes, let nothing be done through selfish ambition or conceit, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than himself. We're just continuing and trying to finish up a little bit on this topic of humility, taking scriptures that apply, that pertain to humility, meditating on them, holding them in our heart, turning them back to the Lord in prayer. This is how the Holy Spirit will sanctify us. We could take this scripture and turn it into a prayer. We can say, Lord, I ask that you would illuminate me by your Spirit. Show me selfish ambition in my heart. Grant me repentance. Lord, show me conceit in my life. Illuminate me. Grant me repentance. Grant, Lord, that I would do nothing through selfish ambition or conceit. These are forms of pride. But Lord, to the contrary, grant that I would have a heart of lowliness and I could prefer others. Meditate on that. Turn it into a prayer. Take these words, as Hosea 14 says, and return to the Lord. He said, I'll be gracious. I'll make you beautiful in holiness. In Romans chapter 11, verse 36, Paul writes, for of him and through him and to him are all things, to whom be glory forever. Meditate on that. Of the Lord Jesus, through him and to him are all things. Tell the Lord, Lord, everything I have is of you. Anything good that ever happens in my life happens through you. And it's all for your glory. Turn that into a prayer. In Luke 14, verse 11, the Lord said, whoever exalts himself will be abased. He that humbles himself will be exalted. 1 Peter 5, 5, God resists the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. Therefore, he says, humble yourself under the mighty hand of God, and he will exalt you in due time. Turn it into a prayer. Hold it in your heart. Don't be anxious to exalt yourself. Promotion doesn't come that way. It comes from the Lord. Our job is to humble ourselves. It's up to God if he wants to exalt us. The Bible says he will in due time. Let's forget about exalting. That's not our job. Our job is to go low. If we go low, we'll get the grace of God. It's in the grace of God that we're transformed. It's in the grace of God that we're sanctified. It's in the grace of God that the life of Jesus begins to manifest through us. Humility is the key to walking in the grace of God. So that's the first topic we looked at. We're talking about taking the Word of God, allowing it to sanctify us unto the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ. Believers and churches must recover the glory of God. God's glory is where there's holiness, where there's purity. When individuals and churches allow compromise, immorality, half-heartedness, prayerlessness, division, finger-pointing, there'll not be any glory of God there. God departs from that. Let's humble ourselves. And let him sanctify us that we can obtain the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ according to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 13 and 14. That's the reason we've been saved, was to be sanctified by the Spirit to obtain the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory, but now we've been redeemed back to the glory. Let's walk in it. Let's pursue the beauty of holiness. That's what the end time bride will walk in. God is going to have an end time church who will arise and shine in the light and the beauty of the Lord Jesus Christ. Because they've allowed the Word of God to sanctify them. They've allowed the Word of God to dwell in them richly, according to Colossians. And that Word is bringing the light of Christ. Psalm 119, verse 130 says, the entrance of His Word gives light. Amen. Well, another topic the Lord led me to meditate on is purity of heart. The Lord said in Matthew chapter 5, blessed are the pure in heart, they shall see God. And it's by beholding Him that we're changed into the same image. We really want revelation of the Lord Jesus. Let's ask Him to give us pure hearts. the purer our hearts become, the better we're able to see. Blessed are the pure in heart. They shall see God. Let's look at a few scriptures on purity of heart and meditate on them. And then we can practice the principle found in Hosea 14. God says, take words and return to me. We can take these scriptures on purity of heart. We can meditate on them, let them dwell in our heart, and then turn that verse back to the Lord in prayer. God will answer that prayer. John the Beloved writes, if we ask anything according to His will, we know He hears us. And if He hears us, we have the thing that we've asked for. If we pray scriptures, I can guarantee you, from the Word of God, that prayer will be answered. So Matthew 5:8, blessed are the pure in heart. Don't you want to see the Lord? Then let's hunger for a pure heart. Let's go before the Lord and ask Him, Lord, purify my heart. Amen. Proverbs 22:11. He who loves purity of heart and has grace on his lips, the king will be his friend. Don't you want King Jesus to be closer? Don't you want King Jesus to be your friend? Then let's have pure hearts. In the Gospel of John, the Lord Jesus Christ said, I no longer call you servants, but friends. He was speaking to his disciples. He said, the servant doesn't know what his master's doing, but the Lord makes known his secrets to his friends. If we want to really flow in the prophetic, let's have a pure heart. God calls us friends if we have purity of heart and have grace on our lips. And He makes known His secrets to His friends. But here's a verse we can meditate on. John 7, verse 18, regarding a pure heart. He who speaks from himself seeks his own glory. But he who seeks the glory of the one who sent him is true, and no unrighteousness is in him. These are the words of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now this tells us something about a pure heart. It's the motive of our heart. Why are we doing what we're doing? Do we preach, sing, pray, serve, prophesy, give? So we can receive glory. So others can esteem us. That's a corrupted motive. The Lord Jesus said, whoever speaks of himself or on his own initiative is seeking his own glory. That's corrupt motive. But Jesus said, speaking of himself, whoever seeks the glory of the one who sent him, whoever seeks the glory of God, that one is true. There's no unrighteousness in him. That's how our hearts become pure. Our motives become pure. Our motive must be to love people, to love everyone, everyone we come in contact with. Our motive must be their good, their welfare. It must be love, the love of Christ. And our motive toward the Lord must be to please Him and to glorify Him, not ourselves. Let's turn that into a prayer. Let's meditate on John 7:18. Let that word sink into our hearts. Then let's turn it into a prayer. Lord, purify my heart. Let my motive be to only glorify You. Let me not be seen. As John the Baptist said in John chapter 3, verse 30, Lord, let me decrease. Lord, increase in my life. If people meet us and they're impressed with us, we failed. But if people meet us and they encounter the fragrance of the Lord Jesus Christ, then God is glorified. I read a story of the Queen of England. I think it was more than 100 years ago. She loved to hear great speakers. I don't remember all the details, but this was a verified story. The Queen of England loved to hear great orators and speakers, so she arranged for some royal meetings where night after night, the greatest speakers in the nation were gathered together to give speeches before the Queen, a royal audience. Of course, she enjoyed it immensely. And among the dozen or so speakers, maybe there were a few more than a dozen, three or four of them were preachers of the gospel. Of course, after each speaker, the Queen would have comments. Remember, these are the finest orators in the nation. After she heard their speech, she would say, "Oh, what a great speaker he is." And then it came time for the preachers. She heard one preacher after another. After she heard the preacher speak, she would give comments like this: "What a fantastic preacher he is." Or, "What a powerful preacher he is." But then, the last preacher was Charles Spurgeon. After she heard him preach, she said, "Oh, my goodness, what a great Savior we have." Amen. You see the difference? When the men were speaking on their own, who got the glory? They did. She heard preachers, and when she was done hearing them, she thought, "What a great preacher." If anyone ever says that about us, we failed completely. But after she heard Charles Spurgeon, she said, "What a great Savior we have." You see, his motive was to glorify the Lord Jesus Christ. If we glorify God, we have a pure heart, if that's our motive. If our motive is to love God, to love people, to glorify God, not ourselves, our motive is pure. In Ephesians chapter 6, verses 5 through 8, we're exhorted. It says, "Servants, be obedient to those who are your masters according to the flesh with fear and trembling, in singleness of heart, as unto Christ, not with eye service, as men pleasers, but as the servants of Christ, doing the will of God from the heart." This is what he's saying. Whatever you do, don't do it to be seen by men. Don't be a man pleaser. That's a corrupted motive. But do everything that you do as unto Christ. If you see some trash on the ground, pick it up because it'll please God, not because anybody else can see. If no one sees, do what you do to please God. That's a pure heart. Let's meditate on these scriptures on having a pure heart before the Lord. As our hearts become pure, we'll see the Lord. Our hearts will become sanctified. We'll see the glory of God. Amen. Well, I hope you can join us next time. We want to continue our study on the topic of regaining the glory of God in the life of the believer and in the church through the pathway of sanctification, holiness unto the Lord. And until next time, you can write to me, if you like, at the email address on the screen. And we'll be happy to pray for any prayer request. My prayer for you is that the Lord would be gracious and give you more of the Spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Jesus, to see Him and to know Him. Amen.